Congratulations, everyone. We've made it to the end of another year. Just a couple more days to go, and I hope you all are having a happy, safe, and warm holiday season. I'm Pat Monahan, and this is the Patcast. This time last year, we were getting on a flight to New York. We played New Year's Eve in Times Square along with Cassidy Pope, Carly Rae Jepsen, and YouTube sensation PSY. Or as I like to say, sigh. We just wrapped up the year doing a couple of Christmas songs in front of the first family at the White House. It's been a pretty crazy great year for us, and we hope you've been able to make your 2013 a year to remember as well. Whether it's with Trains music, or if you came to one of our shows, or if maybe you got to try some Save Me San Francisco wine or chocolate, or maybe just by listening to this podcast, or perhaps by playing the amazing video game, 50 Ways to Survive. Myself, Jerry, and Pergo are working on a couple of end-of-the-year Spotify playlists and stuff like that. And so you can head over to patcast.com and check out our year in review. We'll recap some of the stuff we listened to over the last 12 months and put up a couple of blog posts. And we always love to hear from you. Feel free to hit us up anytime at Patcast Podcast on Instagram and Twitter, or at Train, or at DJ Soff Rock, which is S-O-F-F Rock. That's Jerry. Or if you want to go to Pergo, go to at Pergonomics. These guys, I think, are going to put up some way more interesting stuff than me. I mean, who doesn't want to see the soft rock playlist of the year? Or Pergo, you know, you don't know him, maybe. And if you do, I'm sorry. But he's like a super cool guy from New Jersey. I'm just proud to be, you know, that he remembers my name. And what with this being the end of the year, we thought we would round out the first year of the podcast and the Patcast with a really great interview. This week, it's a country music legend and a dear friend, Martina McBride, along with her husband, John McBride. We've known these two for a long time now, and Martina is a country music, you know, she's royalty to country music, and her husband, John McBride, I consider him royalty as well. In addition to being her sound engineer on tour, he owns, runs one of the most famous recording facilities in Nashville. It's called Blackbird Studios. He's an incredibly interesting man if you ever get a chance to talk to him in person. Martina has won too many awards and had too many number one singles to list here. And after all that, she is still a kind, incredibly down-to-earth, wonderful person. A dear friend, really. Growing up on the greats, Reba McEntire, Linda Ronstadt, Patsy Cline, Martina had music in her blood from an early age. After playing in local bands in Wichita, Kansas for a while, she relocated to Nashville in 1989. She began her recording career in 1991 with RCA Records. 11 albums later, she's still doing it full time. Martina and I met in 2011 when we recorded a Crossroads special for CMT. She brought her powerful voice to Trains music, and we accompanied her on some of her songs as well. The show was pretty well received, but the best part of the whole thing was that we all became fast friends. Martina and John and her band and crew and myself and all of the Train guys got along really wonderfully. And since then, we've collaborated numerous times, and Martina recorded her own version of our song, Marry Me. I was in Nashville for a while last month writing songs with some really talented musicians. And while we were there, I got to sit down for this interview with Martina and John and Train's own Jimmy Stafford. He actually took 5 minutes away from selling Save Me San Francisco wine so he could come out and jam some rock with his friends. That was really exciting for us. That was Jimmy's first appearance on a podcast. He had a great time, and we had a great time having him. We got to talk about how Martina and John met and how they both got started in music, what they're up to now, and they played some of their music, and we got to play some music together. So when we finished up, Martina played us some of her new stuff off of her new record, and I think you can hear a little bit of a new track now on her website. Actually, Dave Stewart of the Eurythmics was in the studio working on a project at the same time that we were there. So it was me and Jimmy and Martina and John and Dave Stewart all sitting around the board listening to some new Martina McBride in an incredible studio. It was a real seriously cool hang for all of us, and I think you'll get a sense of that in the interview that we're about to hear. Not only is Martina one of the all-time great female voices, but her husband is an extremely talented sound engineer and, man, a super funny guy, but a very intelligent guy. So here you got it. Here you have it. Here you want it. It's Martina and John McBride on this week's Patcast. What do you do when nobody's looking? Nobody's looking. What do you do? What do you do when nobody's looking? Nobody's looking. Looking at you. You got to get it while the getting is good. Laugh when you can. Cry when you should. You got to give it till the giving is gone. Do what you can. Then you move on. What do you do when nobody's looking? Nobody's looking. What do you do? What do you do when nobody's looking? Nobody's looking. Looking at you.
No problem. I've never
sat in on one of these podcasts before.
Hey, everybody, can I just go ahead and talk, or we need to check mics?
No, I'm already rolling.
All right.
I've never done this before. This is my first podcast.
You're listening to the great Martina McBride talk. Hey, everybody, I'm Pat Monahan. I'm here with Martina McBride, someone who has become a really good friend of mine. I'm very proud of that. And this is the first time that Jimmy Stafford from Train is going to accompany us on a song. Jimmy, please, when Jerry's out with us, he doesn't talk much. Please don't talk at all during this. I said.
I was abiding by the rules.
Great. So here we are, Martina, at Blackbird Studio, which you have. How much do you have to do with the Blackbird Studio at this point in your life? Everything?
Yeah, quite a bit.
Half of everything?
Yeah, half of everything. No, quite a bit. You know, we're it's an amazing place. I love to. I've made, tons of records here, and yeah. I love recording here. It's got such a great vibe and energy, and you never know who you're going to run into. And
yeah, we just ran into Dave Stewart from the Eurythmics.
Yeah. Yeah,
and
it's crazy.
And here's John McBride.
Thanks, he thought, John, come on in, John.
No.
Come on in.
This is loose, man. I wanted John to sit in because I find you two to be such an interesting couple, and I don't always get to talk to the other people that make us really who we are. And so I gotta let me start by saying hi. Hey, John, how's it going?
Hello, Pat, how are you?
John, you're one of my favorite people along with your wife, but I want to just go back to when you guys met, because I find it to be incredibly interesting. So you're from Kansas, mm-hmm. Martina, mm-hmm. Are you as well?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. So you start out in Kansas. Maybe one of the greatest band names of all time. Is it true that you were in a band called The Penetrators?
Yes, it was.
That is the great. I mean, see, Jimmy, I told you we should have called our band
Man.
The Penetrators.
That's so great.
We could have never played at a high school.
No.
But when did you change the name, or what happened?
No, we never changed the name. But I was so, I grew up on a farm in the town I went to high school in. Very rural community, like
yeah.
I had farmers, 10 people in my graduating class. You can imagine
10
very,
people.
Yeah, sheltered
three
existence.
Were cows. No,
yeah,
three of them what
were cows?
That's just not nice.
Oh, I'm sorry, honey. I'm from the same neighborhood.
No, you're from the big city, Wichita.
That's true.
That is
true.
So anyway, I was 17 years old. Yeah. I just graduated from high school. This couple guys from the band that actually came to my parents' house and talked to them about, the fact that I was going to join the band and travel all over the place, and they would take care of me and whatever. It was a bunch
kind
of crap.
Funny. It's like a sports agent, like a recruiting.
It was weird, but I had no idea, of the double entendre of that name. I just had no idea.
Yeah,
I just thought it was like.
I think there's only one entendre. I think it's just a penetrator, and that's it.
I didn't know. I was like, yeah, cool. Like, penetrate you with our music.
Yeah,
you know?
Man,
I was like,
we're gonna get inside your head.
Okay, so then you
Are you renting? I just want to make sure that some things that I hear are true. So you're renting some space in your band is renting space for gear or rehearsing or whatever.
Yeah. So like after that band, well, that band, you know, I was with that band for about a year.
Okay, so it's a different band.
Moved on.
Oh, I see.
Singing a house band 5 nights a week, and then that
they're called the Lovemakers.
Yeah. Oh my gosh!
That was Baby
anyway.
Daddy.
A couple of bands later, I decided to put my own band together and needed a place to rehearse. So somebody said, you should call John McBride. I think he's building a rehearsal space in his warehouse or something.
And so did you guys, you're in Wichita now?
Yeah.
Okay.
I moved there.
Okay, cool.
And called him on the phone, and it wasn't finished yet. He said, but when it's finished, I'll let you know. And in the meantime, we met.
And your maiden name is Schiff, uh-huh. Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Cool. So you haven't met, you finally run into John, and is it one of those, man, I got to know this guy, or are you just like, I don't care about this guy at all, and he just makes your life miserable,
honey,
till you talk to
it
him?
It won't hurt. Go ahead and tell
No,
you can't hurt me any more than you already have.
The truth is, I was very intrigued by John because he has, as you know, a big personality and a lot of energy. And he was really sweet. He was just sweet, and I could tell he was passionate about what he did, you know, his music and his sound company, and he was kind. And I was like, we were both dating other people at the time, and I was dating a drummer who, I was working 3 jobs, and he wasn't doing anything.
And you didn't have to even explain that
exactly.
To anybody who knows drummers.
Yeah, no kidding.
And so I was, you know, when I met John, he would say things to me like, hey, we're getting like food, you know, you want me to get you something? And I was like, you're actually going to buy me dinner? I mean, I was so, just, that was
yeah,
so
right, because you're
sweet
working
to
hard
me.
To just
yeah,
make things.
To, yeah. And when I moved, I finally broke up with that guy, and he broke up with his girlfriend, and we were kind of had started, we really didn't, weren't seeing each other yet, but I moved into this basement apartment. It was $250 a month. It was like 3 rooms. It was awful, but it was mine, and it was fine. And John, we were going to go out and get a beer or something, and he showed up with like 4 or 5 bags of groceries, like everything I would ever need.
And brought them to your place.
And brought them to my place.
Oh, man, that's
and it was
a
just
really,
like,
really great thing to do.
Yeah,
oh,
really sweet.
I
wasn't
been
used
like,
to it at all.
Where's the wine? Where's the ketchup?
and you got the wrong brand.
Did you recognize in Martina, like right quick, that she was a serious talent to be reckoned with?
Well, I knew she could sing. There's no question about that. I mean, I found that out early on when I set up the monitors for him in that rehearsal room. And then she sang, and I listened to it so that I could just make sure it was EQ'd properly.
And a schizo with that stuff.
When you hear the monitors, those tell the truth.
Yeah.
And the girl could sing.
Yeah,
and
yeah,
there was
yeah.
no doubt. But that isn't what intrigued me. I mean, I've never really... I mean, I care. I'm glad you're a great singer and all that. But it was more her...
Yeah, who she is, right?
Her lust for life, man.
Yeah,
her just her spirit and her soul. That's what got me.
And so you bought the groceries and, you know, and how long before you were like, man, you know what? This guy might be the guy. Was it... Or did you make him buy a couple more groceries? Was it like, this is nice and everything?
I think it was the car or the house.
Yeah. Yeah. No. What else are you going to buy me?
It just started out as a friendship, really. And then he was going on tour. He was a monitor guy for Yngwie Malmsteen.
Wow.
Wow.
That's...
No.
Actually, Steppenwolf, wasn't it?
You hear Fargo? Fargo goes, oh, no.
In 87, it would have been Steppenwolf, probably.
Steppenwolf. Yeah. And
you were out with Steppenwolf?
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Loved him.
As a monitor engineer.
Did you ever get sick of that jam?
No. And every time I heard that song, I just thought, ka-ching.
But how does a guy...
We made it another night and get paid again.
But how does a guy in Wichita find bands like those guys, Steppenwolf and Yngwie? Like, I mean, that's that seems like they'd be in L.A. or Germany.
You know, it's really odd. There was this one particular concert hall in Wichita called the Cotillion Ballroom. 2,200 seats, this round building. And we must have done, as a sound company, probably 500 shows there. Hmm. We'd catch bands on their way up and bands on their way down.
Wow.
And we did everybody from Metallica to, I mean, there was all genres. We did jazz, the Yellow Jackets, Bob, David Sanborn, Bob James, tons of jazz shows, tons of hard rock shows, tons of old rock shows. So anyway, I met Steppenwolf. We had a great night. Hmm. They kept my number.
Yeah, they wanted you to stick around. So did those things lead to you working for Garth? Like, because you have a good friendship with Garth, and Garth is a big part of why I wanted you to be a part of this, because it's a big staple in, I think, your career. And I want to know if everything that I think I know is right. So you're out there working for Garth after all of this. One thing leads to another, right?
Well, what happened was, the way that worked, I got called from a guy I had met on the road, you know, probably at the Cotillion Ballroom, Rick Crabtree, who was the production manager for Ricky Van Shelton. So
these names are all just made up in your brain because they're too good to be true.
So Rick calls me and goes, "Hey, John, we got three shows." It was Stillwater, Oklahoma, Tulsa, Oklahoma, and Arkansas, Jonesboro, Arkansas. Ricky's the headliner. The middle act is this guy named Clint Black, and this is 1989. Hmm. And the opening act's a guy named Garth Brooks.
Wow.
"Can you cover the sound for these three shows?" And I went, "Heck yeah, we'll make it work. It'll happen. It'll rock. It'll be great." So we show up and do these three shows. Garth had no crew with him. He had his manager, and that was it, and a bus driver. And the manager would sit up front of the house and go, "Okay, there's a guitar solo coming up here. There's a piano solo, whatever." And I ran front of house for Garth for those three shows. And my guys did monitors for him. And we hit it off. We knew a few people in common. Mm. So I got to know him just a little bit. And I came home apparently raving about him.
Yeah. Hmm. You said he swings his hat around, he's climbing up on the speakers, it's like amazing.
Yeah, wow, it was fun. No,
but he wasn't even getting started yet, right?
No.
If he's opening for anybody.
This was September of 89. Hmm. His first single was out, "Much Too Young to Fill This Damn Hole." So anyway, we did these three shows, and they were getting ready to, they wanted to hire a front of house guy. And one of the guys who worked for me said, "John, can I go try out for that job?" Hmm. I go, "Yes, of course." I mean... anybody who works with me, I want them to do the greatest they can do, you know. So 2 days later, he takes off for a week with Garth and the band. They liked him. He liked them. He moved to Nashville and got the job. Hmm. 3 months later, we moved to Nashville.
You guys are still living in Wichita? Okay, yes. Now you moved to Nashville.
3 months later, we moved to Nashville.
You're married. You get married in
1988.
25 years this year. Hallelujah.
Wow, man. Congratulations.
Thank you. So anyway, we moved to Nashville. I called Garth. They go, "Hey, I got a warehouse. If you guys want to come practice, I won't charge you, you know, come on over, blah, blah, blah." So they come over and rehearse at night, and we just became closer. And any time that he could bring our sound system, he'd call me and go, "Hey, we got a show in Huntington, West Virginia. It pays $1,500. That's trucking and everything. Can you afford to do it?" And I go, "Yes." Hmm. Pretty much every time.
Yeah.
I'd drive the truck because I couldn't afford to pay a truck driver.
Wow.
We'd set up, do the show, tear down, head back home.
Wow.
So anyway, that's how we got started. And then the fall of 90,
he took off like
a rocket. So he took off like a...
Oh, my gosh.
And were you doing his front of house?
No, I never... You know, it's funny. I did it on those first three shows. But after that, when I'd go do sound for him... And in 1990 also, I went out and did monitors for him for 3 weeks. Hmm. He had 21 shows in 20 days and asked me to come out and do monitors.
Doing monitors is a sure way to never see the guy again. Like, monitor guys are the most disliked people in the all of music business.
Except for me.
Yeah, John's a really good monitor guy.
Because I've heard Steven Tyler would have a guy at the board and a guy behind the guy at the board and then a guy in the bus waiting because they were all going. It was just a matter of time.
Rotation, that's right.
And so when does Garth hear you sing? Because the rumor is that he hears you sing and he likes John and he likes you and he's like, "Hey man, go get a record deal and I'm let you come out with me." Or is that just not the way?
You
want to
tell it the way it happened?
Well, I mean, I'm trying to remember. I don't think he ever heard me sing until after I had a record deal.
That's correct.
So I went out and sold t-shirts for him. You know, John and I were basically newlyweds, and I was waiting tables here in Nashville and singing demos and was, you know, missing my husband because he would be out. They've toured like crazy,
right,
like weeks and weeks and weeks at a time, like you guys do.
Like real rock, like men do.
Yes.
That would be correct.
So I said, you know, can I get a job on the road out there doing something so we can travel together? And so I got a job selling t-shirts and did that for like, maybe 9-10 months. In the meantime, was working on trying to get a record deal here in Nashville, and an opportunity came up with RCA Records. They said they're looking to sign a female artist, and there's three contenders, and so I did a showcase. And
wow. And let me tell you just a little bit about the showcase. We put together a great band, but everybody that worked for Garth at this point knew Martina.
Hmm.
So they all came to the show. Garth's LD did the lighting for us. I did front of house. I think Brent did monitors probably. Mm-hmm. And Garth's parents came. The whole band and crew came.
I had my little posse.
That's amazing.
Oh, she my had Garth a lot of fans posse at that show. So yeah, sorry cool to interrupt.
Did you have songs worth playing? Like, did you have the songs from your first record, or was it?
I had one song from my first record that ended up making the record, and then other original songs, you know, and a couple covers.
Couple of covers.
I probably did 6-7 songs.
But it was more about you and your voice. Like, that's what they knew what they were looking for, right? Because there's hundreds and hundreds of great writers right, you know, at everybody's doorstep. They mm-hmm. know that if you have what they want, they can help you achieve what they think you're capable of. It's a lovely kind of program here, because I'm learning a little bit more about Nashville and songwriters and the camaraderie between artists and songwriters, mm-hmm. and, you know, that many artists are songwriters and many songwriters are artists, etc. But that combination where all of you kind of do the same thing and you're a family is really lovely here.
It is.
And so you get the showcase. Garth Brooks' parents, who they come to a lot of train shows too, by the way. Just don't get a big head, is all I'm saying. They're here watching you. You have your posse, and you play for RCA. Are you out of your mind, scared?
So nervous. Yeah. I just remember being really nervous.
How old were you?
I was 23, 24.
That would have been really 90. Young. Let me think about this.
It's okay.
You're probably 24.
Yeah, a long time ago.
24.
24. Sounds great.
But, and my parents came in from Kansas. They drove down. And they came back that night, the record label guy, Josh Leo, and said, "You have a record deal." And I was like, "What?"
Wow.
He said, "Yeah, come in tomorrow. I want to talk to you."
Wow.
About it. And it was just surreal, you know? Mm. It was just very surreal after working for... I mean, I hadn't really been here that long. I can't say that I've labored here for years and years, but just, you know, after singing all my life and wanting that so badly, it was finally happened. It was crazy.
Yeah.
And Garth's mom said to Josh Leo, "If you don't sign her, I will." That's what she said.
So what exactly? I don't know.
But yeah,
yeah, she's going to work at my my five and dime store.
Yeah. Well, anyway, it was cool.
You know, I'm glad that there's some, you know, truth to what... What do you got, John?
Yeah, I want to finish this. One night, okay, we'd gone out on tour, and it was 1991. Martina was selling t-shirts. I was production manager for Garth. He calls one night, goes, "Hey, can you guys come by?" So we go to his house. He'd bought this big house, swimming pool, the whole bit. We go out by the pool. He starts asking her about the record.
Hmm.
And he goes, "Is there something you can sing?" And she sings a little bit of a song called "When You Are Old." And his first comment was, "Well, that'll be a cheap record to make. You don't need a band." You
know, whatever.
And then he goes, in his true Garth style, "Martina, I have a favor to ask you."
No, he said, "If you don't mind."
Oh, yes.
"If you don't mind, I'd like for you to open all my shows next year."
Wow, man.
I was like, "I don't mind that. No. Yeah. No. I'm there. I'll be there."
She goes, "Let me think about it." Okay.
Yeah.
No, it was great.
That's what happened.
You know, there's a thing that's here in Nashville. I'm trying to like figure out what it is, because it's people are so good to each other, and there's a family. And I talked to Vince earlier today, and he thought I was saying that it's a closed family, but what I was saying is it's a close family.
Mm-hmm.
And you're always willing to let people in, but there's a certain there's a certain thing that, you know, you have to deliver to the family before you're asked in. And obviously you and Garth and John and, you know, there's a family thing that you guys all have. Is it still like that? Because now more rock bands are coming to Nashville. There's like this longing for the camaraderie and the, mm-hmm. the songwriting vibe and people still telling stories, great American stories. There's still this essence that this is really where the value of music still exists, but also the loveliest people in the music business. Like everywhere I go, there's the sweetest people and they live in the biggest damn houses I've ever seen in my life. Like, is there a bad neighborhood here? Because I'd like to go there just to know that it exists. But do you think that it's still like it used to be? Do you still feel like if your children are going to be in the music business, this is the loveliest place for them to do it from?
Yeah, it's a beautiful place. It really is. There's a, like we talked about earlier, there's a huge sense of community. And, you know, I'm sure there's competition, but I've never really felt competitive. Like, I feel like everybody kind of roots for everybody else. And don't you think?
It's very hip-hop. It's kind of like you guys taught hip-hop, guys. When rap was, like, coming up, the way Vince put it, I didn't. Hold on a second. He didn't mention hip-hop ever.
Okay.
I did, because I was trying to compare it, because he said there was never anything to lose. Like, none of us had anything to lose. So we were always wanting what we were doing here to work. Mm-hmm. We always wanted our music to work and exist. And the only way to do that is to do it together. So we were always play on each other's records and go to each other's shows and sing on each other's songs and all the other things that people would do. And then the hip-hop guys started rap, which had nothing to lose. And they were all on each other's... And guys in rock bands like Train, we were out there trying to slash people's tires so they couldn't get to the show so we could be the headliner. And then how could I burn down that guy's house so that he doesn't make records anymore? Like, you know, we were so competitive that it was just ridiculous. And now, because iTunes and everything exists and there's not that shelf space to be fighting over,
right.
Now there's less competitive nature and more of a, hey man, let me sing on your record, or will you do this for me, and can you be a part of this? Because now we all got nothing to lose. And it's a very interesting concept about all of that. And it still exists here? You feel like everybody's still doing it? The new age, the Carrie Underwoods and everybody are still behaving as a family like you guys all did?
Well, I'm not privy to that a lot, you know, that what the new artists are really doing as far as all that. I mean, I hope so. I really, really hope so. Because this is the kind of town where, you know, I can call Dolly Parton and she'll come sing on my record, or Vince sing on
Dolly
my record.
Can you call Dolly Parton right now?
Yeah, yeah, okay. Right now. She'll be here in 10 minutes. No, but, it's about passing, it's about carrying on tradition as well.
Right.
That's a huge part of this.
Where did
community.
The tradition come from for you? What inspired you? Like, I read that, you know, people's parents usually are the gateway to music that you love. Mm-hmm. Is it the same way with you guys?
It was, yeah. My dad was a hardcore country music fan, you know, but he had, there were other artists that were on the fringe that he loved as well. Like, he loved some of the outlaw country, like when it came out, like Waylon Jennings and he loved, but he also loved Etta James and he loved Elvis and he loved Carl Perkins and some of the rockabilly music and you know, ZZ Top was acceptable in our house. You know, it's like my dad was not a rock music fan as far as what was on the radio, but there are certain artists that kind of just cover all genres, like Ray Charles, for example. He was a huge Ray Charles fan. Well, and so
he's kind of country music in a lot of ways, you know.
Yeah,
he went through that phase.
He cut a great country record
in a similar way. But even when he wasn't writing country songs, he wrote similar like great stories.
Yeah, there's an honesty to it that I think my dad, you know, could get with. And
he had a band.
My dad had a band. Yeah.
Did he play guitar?
Mm-hmm. Play guitar and sang.
Is that how you got started singing?
Yeah.
That people even knew
completely.
You could sing?
Yeah, because we lived, like I said, far out in the country. It was very rural. There was nothing to do, but there were a lot of musical instruments around, and I just always loved to sing, and there was always music in the house. And so I started singing in the band when I was about, I guess, 7 years old.
Hmm. Do you have siblings?
I do. I have a younger brother who played guitar, started about the same time. He's 2 years younger than me. He plays guitar in my band now.
Right.
Acoustic guitar. And then I have an older brother who played drums for a while in the band, and an older sister. So, but it was just always like what I felt that I was supposed to be doing.
Yeah.
And to have that kind of environment to really nurture it in, and to, for them, it didn't feel weird. It wasn't like, you know, it was very natural.
Yeah. It feels that way for most everyone that does this podcast with me has a very similar story. Like, mm-hmm. I don't have a choice. There was no backup plan. Backup plans were like,
yeah,
just more of this. Like, mm-hmm. failure is the only backup plan. And John, you know, you have the biggest Beatles collection that I think mm-hmm. anyone that lives has, from records and posters and authentic, you know, paraphernalia. Was that what you grew up with? Like, how did that happen? Because I can't imagine.
Yeah, my dad brought home a Beatle record, and that did it for me.
But before that, before the Beatles, were you turned on to anything else? Because, you know, like George Jones, who they did a tribute to yesterday, mm-hmm. He was, I mean, that guy was bad, bad dude.
He's an amazing guy.
And yes. Elvis had so much to mm-hmm. do yeah. with Nashville. And was that, did that make an impression?
Well, I loved, you know, pop radio.
Right.
But my pop radio was the Beatles and the Stones and Rod Stewart. And,
yeah.
you know, even Led Zeppelin had some songs on the radio. You know, we had such great music when I was growing up. And I fell in love with the Beatles first and foremost. But then I also listened to anything on the top 40. And, you know, I loved those records. However, I do remember listening to a few albums prior to the Beatles. One was, they were show tunes.
You were into show tunes. I knew that about you. I was going to say, I know that that's a show tunes guy in his heart.
I was gay until now.
I knew.
You know? Well, that hurts when I sit down. But anyway, I'm sorry. I don't want to take this show to a bad level.
I'm so glad that you are.
It's got the explicit label.
Yeah, we put the explicit label on, so it's perfect.
But what one was... Dr. Doolittle or Dr. Eliza, you know,
the Rain My Fair Lady.
Yes, My Fair Lady.
Oh, yeah.
The Rain in Spain stays mainly on the plane.
Yeah.
I played the grooves out of that record, man. I did. I loved it. There's a couple others. Camelot. Oh, I remember listening to that one.
Man, you got to stop talking about show tunes right now. I'm just, everybody, the reputation in this whole program is.
I love it.
Actually,
love
it's it. Like, it's, you know, any great melodic, memorable, anything is like hard not to like.
Yeah.
I mean, and nowadays there was a phase heavy in all of our lives because we're similar ages. So when we talked about music as kids, you had to like a thing. You couldn't like 10 things.
Right.
You couldn't be like, well, I really love Chet Baker, but I also like Chet Atkins, and I really like Michael Jackson. And you'd be like, well, then you need to go to jail. You weren't allowed. And now it's like, if you have any divisions, you're just not a big-minded person, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So
right.
liking show tunes and rock and rockabilly and all that, like, that just makes sense. You're a very smart guy.
So. You're ahead of your time.
Martina turned me on to country music.
Wow, really?
Which she really did.
Isn't that funny?
I mean, the crossover stuff I knew, like Don't It Make My Brown Eyes Blue, A Boy Named Sue, Luke and Bach, Texas. A few of the country songs that have made it to pop radio.
Right.
I knew those, liked them.
Right.
You know, Waylon's record was the first country record I ever bought.
Well, you know,
but she enlightened me to the art of country music.
There is an art.
Oh,
and
yes.
I'm learning more and more and more that the art is really still alive and well.
Yes.
Speaking of music and songs, the reason that we met originally was to do a Crossroads.
Mm-hmm.
And I wondered if you would mind if we could play one of those songs that we did on Crossroads. Can we do that now?
Absolutely, yeah.
And Jimmy.
Yes.
This is where you earn your $7 and your cup of coffee.
Thanks.
Am I done?
Cool. No, you can come back and I would love for you to be a part of whatever you'd want to be a part of. All right. This is Marry Me.
Forever
could never be long enough for me to feel like I've had long enough with you. Forget the world now, we won't let them see, but there's one thing left to do. Now that the weight has lifted, love has surely shifted my way. Marry me today and every day. Marry me if I ever get the nerve to say hello. Close enough for me to feel like I am close enough to you. So you went white, now wear out the words I love you, and you're beautiful. Now that the wait is over and love is finally shown her my way. Marry me today and every day. Marry me if I ever get the nerve to say hello in this cafe. Say you will.
So great.
Thank you for singing that with me.
That's so great.
You guys sound so good together.
I have to tell you that, you know, we met at Crossroads, and I was very flattered that you agreed to do that. I find you to be a legend, and I know that your husband does, and millions of fans of yours. And when we did that, I got to witness a lot of things about you and your family in Nashville, and it was really, there couldn't have been a better crossroads, but also like a welcoming to Nashville.
It was a magical night.
Music. It was.
It really was a magical night.
It was a magical night.
We were nominated for a CMT award for that performance.
Yeah,
should have won.
Yeah, I felt a huge connection with you guys from the second we, you know, stepped on stage together. It's been a blessing for sure.
Yeah, for us too. I feel like, you know, we have a friendship now, and I'm so grateful for it. And I know that, you know, for a lot of musicians, the career is very short, you know, especially in our genre. Like the fact that we're still making records that people, even anybody, cares about is very, it's very hard to do. And mostly it just doesn't happen. So in country music, somehow people go longer and sometimes forever. Mm-hmm. And it's such a lovely thing to be a witness to. I fear that if I ever try to come into your world too heavy-handed, it would be maybe a mistake. I wouldn't want this community that I think of so highly to think I'm a fraud. You know, mm-hmm. but I do love country music, and I love to actually be a part of it and write it. And so hopefully I'll be able to make a bunch of records with you, and we'll be able to sing a bunch, and maybe I can slowly make a way into, like, the hearts of the people that I admire the most. You know, well, there's, like, a real camaraderie here that I would love to have more in my life.
Mm-hmm. And tour together.
You know, you have a lot of fans. In country, you have a lot of fans in the world, obviously, but especially here, even in Nashville, I talk to people all the time who are huge fans and who love that Crossroads show that we did together.
Oh,
and
cool.
And so, I mean, you know, part of it is, I think this community, it can be very closed. It's very interesting, you know. Mm. It's not like I want to tell you or anybody that's I don't know. It's weird, but it's like they can sense an honesty and you know, where your heart is.
Yeah.
And that's what really, I think, matters the most. And
I think that's why I like it so well.
Yeah.
Because my family, you know, I'm the last of seven kids, and my family was no bullshit. Like, mm-hmm. that was the worst thing you could do, is try to get away with some stuff, you know, like, because it'd be like, oh, really? Well, then we're just going to prove you wrong and then mortify you. We're gonna destroy you in front of everybody. And there's something that, like, I like about that.
Yeah.
I like that, hey, man, nobody's going to let me get away with stuff. Mm-hmm. And there's kind of that here. Because mm-hmm. everybody knows everything. This town
is full of accountability.
Massive stars, but it is small and people know everything.
Yeah.
I have to say one thing, and then I'm going to improve your show greatly by leaving. When you were talking about Martina, you know, it's funny. She was nominated for Female Vocalist of the Year 18 out of 19 years.
It's incredible.
Row.
And you still
are
tied with the most wins, right? As the Female Vocalist of the Year. That's incredible.
And the girl is such a class act, and she's had a long career, and deservedly so. One thing that bothers me about country is it seems like we're trying to kiss everybody's ass. You know, we have the CMA Awards. There's a lot of people that we invite to these shows, I guess trying to get the ratings up or whatever it is.
It makes a lot of sense.
I think the country community should have more pride. I mean, you know what?
Well, I don't think it's pride. I think it's they should believe in themselves more.
Yes, yeah. Yes, exactly.
Yeah, believe in it more.
Exactly.
Than,
and be proud of what we do.
Like, even if ratings aren't great, you know, having Paris Hilton to your program, yeah, maybe the ratings are going to go up slightly in one area, but then you're going to lose credibility in another area. And I think that you have to really think about how that balance is going to work.
You do.
But that goes for all things.
Right.
If, you know, I think that you have to understand also that there's categories within this town and within the genre of country music. There's the holy shit that are amazing. Those are songwriters in the Hall of Fame. And when people open their voices, you go like, everybody shut up forever. I never want to do this again because that's how good they are. Then there's the pop version.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
You know, there's the kids that are kind of getting away with being the loudest on the radio and the most heard, but no one really is good. There's no legitimacy in all of it. You know, there are different categories of all of it. It's just that I think you guys are so in the legitimate category, and the we're long-term, this lives in us, this is what we want to pass on traditionally to the next generations and everything, that you care. So when you see the fraud, it gets you upset.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
But to others, like, it's just, I don't know, it's a part of the gag anyway, you know? It's like the award show, it depends on how much legitimacy you really think an award show has. If you really think that it's a legitimate program, then yeah, you should be offended. But if you kind of know what it is at this point, then you go like, whatever.
Well, what's funny is Nashville is so much hipper than its perception.
Mm-hmm. I don't know, I think the perception is getting better.
Yeah.
Well, Jimmy's new to Nashville, what's the perception?
Well, I agree. I think it's way hipper than the perception. I mean, you know, when I moved here 5 years ago,
5 years
ago, yeah, I thought I was coming to just this nice little quiet country town. I grew up in the Midwest, so that's kind of, I wanted to come back to that. When I got here, what I discovered was This town knows how to party. There's like just a great vibe here. And like you were saying earlier, there are a lot more like rock acts that are here. I've met mm-hmm. some of my rock idols that live near me and have become friends. And it's just kind of a, it's a big city, but it's a small town.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, the funny thing is we're also having a huge migration, or we always have a steady migration of great players that come from LA and New York, and they end up in Nashville because it's the last bastion of everybody showing up at the same time, playing music, making a record, you know, as opposed to building one in your bedroom or whatever. It happens more here than anywhere else. And I think that attracts talent. And then anytime there's another mudslide or a riot or whatever happens in LA, people go, you know what? I'm going to go to Nashville.
Yeah.
And it makes sense. They can make a great living here. And that's good. You know?
And there's no mudslides.
Right.
And earthquakes.
Right. All that good stuff. So anyway, have fun.
You leaving?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm gonna let you guys... I don't have much time left. She can have her life back.
Don't say that. I'll stay out here an hour if you need to, whatever. You go ahead and start recording now, all right?
Oh, right. Oh, no.
So what I do want to ask you about, how many albums do you have? Do you have 20 albums?
No.
Because you have Christmas, how many Christmas albums have you made? Two or three?
One.
No, there's two, right?
There's a repackaging.
Oh, okay. Yeah. All right. Yeah. But have that. You made 20 albums?
Do I've
you
have made a 11.
Album catalog?
Catalog. I've made 11 albums.
11 albums.
But I mean, then,
you know, most people don't get to make 11 albums in their lives.
I know.
It's kind I'm of really incredible. Lucky. Is there one that you're most proud of?
You know, that's so hard because there are different stages in my life, you know?
Right.
Like, I can remember... I feel like Evolution was an evolution for me, you know.
That's named my wife's favorite. That's what she's like. I listen to that as much as I listen to anything else.
Wow.
Yeah, that was a big record for her.
Well, that's cool because it's kind of like I kind of came into my own as an artist with that record and then Emotion, the record I made, a record. Well, Wild Angels was really, you know, I remember specifically what I wanted to do with that record. Like, I wanted to make sort of an old sort of Linda Ronstadt kind of 70s California kind of record. And I wanted it to be kind of rough around the edges and not polished. And so I remember that very clearly. And then Emotion, I went out and did Lilith Fair and was really, really influenced by, I was probably 30, maybe. I was super influenced by that scene and how it was so...
They had really great, it was a good run.
And it was just a really cool vibe, and the music was great. All the indie music and just that whole thing was so cool. And I really influenced that record, Emotion, because I can remember sitting on the back porch with John on the, you know, a couple weeks before that record came out, saying, this is not country at all. Like, I'm probably going to get, this might be careeracide right here. Hmm. And he was like,
careeracide. I never heard that.
Because we put loops, you know, we were one of the first.
Yeah, that's the problem with being influenced.
Yeah,
because you probably influenced all those guys or all those girls as well. And so they may have started to get into their more of their country aspect.
But I remember coming back, we did loops and we did sort of just songs that were kind of alternative sounding. And John said to me, well, you got time. I mean, do you want to change it? And I was like, no, I don't want to change it.
Right.
I'm just trying to mentally prepare myself for what might happen. But sure. But then at that moment I knew I don't want to change it. Of course, I love it. So, I mean, that record is really a growth kind of record for me.
Is there an album that you wish you could have taken back and redone it?
Nope.
Nothing.
Mm-mm.
Oh, that's great. See, I definitely have that. Maybe two. Okay, six. I've got six of those. Actually, there's just one record that I wish I could take back and two records that I wish I could take back and reprogram. But not wanting to redo anything, that's a big deal. That means you're making really good decisions that are going to last. Are you able to do that as a parent? Are you making good decisions? Are your kids making good decisions that are going to last?
I think so.
I met one of your daughters, and man, she is a serious contender for one of the greats of all time. Like, she's... your other two children are like Delaney, you got a good box of crayons going on.
Yeah. We have three great girls. They're really smart and funny and individual and kind and compassionate and just, we have a great time together.
The connection with music and being a parent, how heavy is that? Does one influence the other?
I don't understand exactly.
As a parent, are you influenced by other people's music and how to parent? Or does having children influence your music? Or, you know, somehow, what is the combination of...
You know what? I've been asked that before. You know, when I first had kids, it was like, I got the question a lot, how does this influence your music or change it? And I don't know that it does. I think they're kind of... you wouldn't know
because it's just who you are, right?
Yeah. But I do hear a lot of cool music from them. You know, that's the cool thing about having kids and young...
I know, right?
I hear so much and then stuff that I would never know about.
And then you bring music home... And they're young, and you go, like, they like it. Maybe this has a chance. That's why I keep telling my wife, we have to have a new baby every 5 years for the next 30 years. Well, I wanted to ask you a couple of other things before I just get to my wife's questions. But is there someone who, when you hear her sing or him sing, you go, like, oh, that makes me crazy. That's so good. Like, I have a list of people that I can't believe how good they are at singing. They never do anything wrong. And when they sing, it's just so beautiful. And even like Tom Waits, somebody deep like that, it's just so admirable that he can even do that. Mm-hmm. Who are those people for you?
Aretha Franklin.
Man, have you ever sung with her?
No.
Ah.
But I mean, she just kills me. Like, it's crazy. It's like, for me, Aretha Franklin and Ray Charles are like above and beyond everybody else.
All others, yeah.
And this is going to sound cheesy and weird, and I don't want to be cheesy or weird, but I love your voice. It really, really makes me crazy.
I love your voice. It's so great. It makes me crazy. I love, like, you're in the category of, in this town, when I think of like the greatest singers I've ever heard, I think of you and Vince Gill. Like, I really do. And there's a new guy. His name is Chris Stapleton.
Oh yeah, he's good.
That kid, yeah, man, he's nutty. But
who are some of your favorite singers? I mean, you know, like I said, Aretha. And,
you know, when I hear James Taylor sing something, I just go,
"Yeah, he
could sing the worst song in the world," and I'd be like, "I get it, I'm buying it." You know,
so
and
good.
It's so effortless. He makes it sound so easy when he could, sings.
If he sang to me like, I'm going to come to your house and kill you. I'd be like, that sounds great. Yeah.
You know, can I harmonize with him?
He's coming to my house.
Kill me.
Heck, I'm going to kill me. Yeah. So, yeah, it's a little weird. And I think about, but there's so much great music here. It's hard to know, like, what you can admire because I've run into different people every day and worked with different writers and every time I leave, I go like, oh man, I never met anybody as good as that. Like, and then the next part, I never met anybody better than that. Like, there's talent here that's, it's like my father who loved words so much and great singing. And it's like, I wish he was alive so I could bring him here and go like, this is what you were talking about all those years that existed, you know?
Yeah.
Because we listened to pop radio and he thought, oh, you know, the whole world has passed me by. But the whole world didn't because Nashville is right where he would be. You know, he would love it.
Yeah, there's a treasure trove here for sure.
Yeah. Well, anyway, I'm probably moving here, so the real estate stuff's going to go down. So let me give you my wife's 6 questions.
Okay,
and,
awesome.
And please drink the wine that I brought you, some Drops of Jupiter. I'm a big fan of it. I think it's excellent.
I love it, too.
Enough of it, weird shit is going to happen.
Okay. Let's open it now.
Amen. So my wife's first question always is, how did you meet your wife or your spouse? But we've discussed that way far more than I wanted to. John just wouldn't stop talking about it. What is your best tour find? What's the best thing you found on the road after all these years, like a great burger joint or a record store or a hair salon or something magical that you wouldn't have found otherwise?
That's such a good question. Well, In-N-Out Burger in L.A.
Yeah, people like that.
That's really good.
A lot of Instagram pictures of In-N-Out.
I've done it myself.
Yeah, have you?
It's yes. funny.
It's the Chick-fil-A of the West.
Yeah, it's so good. We have a couple places on the road that we go, like, we end up inevitably having a day off, you know, not every year, but every couple years. There's a place called, is it Coeur d'Alene?
Yeah.
Coeur d'Alene, and is it Idaho?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And there's that little, see, one of my crew guys is here behind me.
Yeah, that's
great. So. Alan, what's that restaurant we go to, the it's like the lodge, you know?
Bob
it's not
Evans?
The Moose Lodge. But the Moose
Lodge. VFW?
No.
Right, exactly.
It's really good.
Anyway, like
and
little
it's in
restaurants.
Utah.
It's in Idaho.
Idaho,
right,
oh, okay.
Right over the Washington border. I think
oh, really?
There's a lake there, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm. Coeur d'Alene. We've spent some days off there. That's fun. And I spent my birthday. I always get to spend my birthday in cool places.
Oh, that's great.
We spent my birthday on Lake Tahoe 1 year.
When is your birthday?
July 29th.
Oh, that's a good touring day.
Exactly. Yeah. We're always touring. Yeah.
Everybody's on the road on July 29th. We're all celebrating your birthday somewhere. Yeah. What are you a fan of currently? A football team or somebody's record or a movie or
what? I'm a fan of this TV show called Parenthood. It's
on really?
NBC. Huh. It's just brilliant.
Oh,
it's
cool.
So well done.
I love the cast.
Yeah. It's in like its sixth season or fourth season, I'm sorry. And people are just starting to find out about it. But for some, I love one of the actors and two of the actors in that, that why I was intrigued in the first place, Lauren Graham, who was on the Gilmore Girls, which was one of my favorite shows.
Yeah.
And then Mae Whitman, who I've followed for, she's just an amazing young actress. And so they were both on the same show. So I was like, oh, I'm going to check this out. And I've just been a diehard fan ever since.
Oh, that's cool.
It's really good.
They made fun of Hey Soul Sister, I think, in their first season.
They did?
Yeah. Because they had really hipster friends. And then...
No, that was a sitcom that was Parents something.
Oh, I thought it was Parent. Oh, yeah, you're right. It's not. It wasn't that. I'm so sorry. I'm just always trying to include me in everything.
I think that show got canceled.
Actually. They got canceled because they shouldn't have made fun. I'm telling
exactly.
you.
Exactly.
Why still do this? Like, what prompts you to just not stop?
I love it.
Yeah.
I love singing.
Do you love to travel or just like, would you rather just make records or write songs or tour or the combination is what does it?
The combination is great. I have a little bit of love hate I'm enjoying touring now more than I ever have.
Yeah, because like, your children are old enough.
My children are old enough to kind of, you know, I mean, it's hard when you have little ones and you come on, you know, you go out and you do the show and then you come back. I don't know. I don't want to complain because it was awesome as well. I don't want to seem like I was complaining, but it was just exhausting.
Yeah.
And you know, so to
and the guilt and stress and all that stuff is really will take its toll on you.
Yeah. But I'm just loving it now. And you know, there's nothing like being on stage and having that connection with an audience.
Yeah.
I mean, aren't you so grateful that we get to have that? It's
totally.
So amazing.
Yeah, it's
like
nutty.
Yeah.
As long as you don't believe, you know, I've heard people say, like, you can never be your biggest fan.
Well,
that's when it becomes a problem. You know.
That's no problem for me. I'm usually going, oh, that sucked. I sucked.
It's funny. Like, that's what I find about successful, ambitious people is that there's just never a satisfying moment where you can go like, okay, I kind of did it. So I'm good now. I can move on.
Mm-hmm.
Which leads me to the next question is, like, what's left for you? What is it that you want to do? Is there, like, sell out Madison Square Garden or something that is maybe a moment that you could rest after?
I have a lot of records in my head that I want to make that aren't necessarily, you know, mainstream country records. So that's exciting for me to kind of...
And you're currently in the middle of one now, right?
Yeah.
Can you tell everybody about it or...
Yeah, I'm finishing up an album now. Actually, I produced with Don Was, who... And it's an album of soul and R&B covers that, you know, for me...
That's just one of lots of different records that...
But it's exciting because they're great songs.
Yeah.
And great
he's
melodies.
A bad, bad
he
dude
is so
when it
great.
Comes to that stuff. So he's going to... I'm sure this record is incredible.
But you know, I've always said I'd like to sing the Super Bowl the national anthem at the Super Bowl. Oh, I don't know why. It just seems like it would be a really amazing thing to be able to do.
You sing one this past summer at a NASCAR race.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah. Was that the Daytona 500?
Mm-hmm. It was. That was
you did an incredible
job.
Thank
you.
Yeah.
Thanks.
So you just told us what's next. Are you going out on tour this summer, or how can people find your tour dates or know what you're going to do? Are you going to tour this record?
I'm super excited about touring this record because for me, part of making this record, you know, there's the making of the record and that's fun. But for me, the vision of actually taking it on the road, we're going to have a horn section and background singers. And we're all going to
take your band, your regular band, and they're going to play the whole thing.
Yeah.
Wow. That's
and then
great.
There's the cool thing of integrating, you know, the hits or my body of work with this new music.
Okay. So you'll do both.
Yeah.
Oh, that's fun.
Definitely.
Oh,
yeah.
That's great.
Yeah.
So I guess the last question is, how do people find out more about you? Because I want to follow you on Instagram, and I is it Martina McBride? Uh-huh. And how about Twitter and Facebook
McBride.
And all that stuff?
And Martina McBride.
Wow, it's so complicated. Why didn't you just stick with one thing?
Yeah. No, it's all, and you know what's interesting? I started out with this whole social media thing, like being kind of freaked out by it.
Yeah.
It's just different, you know?
Yeah.
It's like, what do you mean I'm going to put all my thoughts out there? And I mean, we kind of grew up where everything was kind of private and there was some mystery but now I love it. I really love it. And I do all my own stuff. So I do all my own Facebook. I didn't until about 8 months ago. I decided to get to start doing that. So I do like all of that, and the Twitter and the Instagram is all me, and it's really Vine as well. Wow. It's really
That's
fun.
Awesome.
Yeah.
I don't know if Perga will have to edit this, but my favorite tweet of all time. It's from a kid in a band called Waves.
Okay.
And I guess he's very funny, very punk rock. So he tweets, "Hey, Kings of Leon, I know that your record label does your Twitter. I just wanted you to know that you should suck my balls." The fact that you're doing your own communicating with your fans, I think, is an awesome thing. It's a big deal. You know, it's kind of the way you should do it.
And it does feel like communicating, you know?
Yeah. They have access to you. And I think that's, you know, I don't know if you owe anybody anything, but it's certainly great for a fan if you respect them like they respect you on some level, you know?
Yeah, I love it.
Is there anything that you wish I would have asked you about that could make me better at this? And I'm so sorry, Jimmy, you had to be here the whole time. I know you don't really, or anything I missed?
No,
anything
it was
that
awesome.
You were hoping that I would.
You're good at this.
I'm getting there.
Yeah he's really good
I'm
at it,
getting
right?
There.
Yeah.
But I'm so glad that you did this, and I'm so glad that we're friends, and that John is my friend as well. And
yes.
Thanks for doing this, Jimmy.
Yeah,
my pleasure.
Sorry you had to sit through all my nonsense, but Martina McBride, I can't wait to hear your new record. Do you have a name for it?
Yes, it's called Everlasting.
Everlasting by Martina McBride. All right.
All right.
Look for it, and we'll see you on Instagram.
All right.
Thanks.
Thanks. That was fun.
All right. Patcast Podcast at Instagram and Twitter. Or you could go to patcast.com if you want to go to the website. Martina McBride is Martina McBride at Instagram and at Twitter. Or you can go to martinamcbride.com. Her latest record, Everlasting, will be out in March. I can't wait to hear that. It's going to be super cool. I think that the first track that they let people listen to is one of my favorite artists of all time, Van Morrison, one of his songs. So I'm happy that's the first one you get to hear, because all the rest of them are great as well. Early Happy New Year's to everybody. I hope everybody's safe. If you're going to drink, please don't drive. If you are going to drink, please drink San Francisco wine. It tastes delicious. If you are going to drive, please drive slow. Wave to people and be nice. Don't do what Pergo does. He's such an angry driver. When I go to the airport with him, I pretend that I'm reading or sleeping because he is so angry. So
they're asking for it.
Let's start a new great year in 2014 with better manners and better Pergos. Happy New Year.